She's strong, kind, and surrounded by duck calls. Duck Dynasty's Korie Robertson shares her redneck wisdom on raising kids on today's 700 Club Interactive. Well, welcome to the show. Willie and Korie Robertson's adventures on Duck Dynasty have made them and their children fan favorites. So what's the secret of their success as parents? Take a look.
Many fans of the hit reality show Duck Dynasty wonder how Willie and Korie Robertson have managed to raise such good kids. In her book, Strong and Kind, Korie shares her time-tested practices for parenting and talks about character traits kids need to lead successful lives.
Well, Korie, welcome to the show. We've had lots of Robertsons on this show. It's a pleasure to have you with us.
I'm happy to be here.
You had a family tradition growing up, and while you were growing up, I don't think you really enjoyed it much, but it left you with something. What was it?
Yeah, well, when you're kids and you're on family vacation, you don't really want to stop and have, like, family devo time. You know, you want to just be at the beach.
Time to play.
That's right. But whenever we were, every time we went on vacation, my dad got us all together to have a time where we talked about the values that were important to our family, and we actually made a principles for living for our family, and it's a list that it was up to all of us to come up with what was important to us, what values we held dear, what things like treating other people more importantly than you treat things, and sharing and caring, and all those things that we wanted to and we were vowing to do as a family, and that made an impact on me and on how we raise our kids.
Did you know at the time why he was doing it?
You know, I think as a kid, you kind of, you know, you get it. You understand that, okay, this is something important, but you don't really want to sit down and do it. And you don't ever really understand until later what kind of impact that will make on you.
Mm-hmm. What was the impact on you?
I think the impact on me was really about being intentional about how we live. You know, it matters. Mm-hmm. Me having good character, having integrity, having values, those things matter. And the way that we live our lives on ours, and when as kids, you know, to look, I think a lot of times it's hard for us to look at our kids as adults, but I think it's important for us to see our kids as the adults that we want them to be. And, you know, whenever they're throwing a temper tantrum, you know, in the grocery store at 3, it's tough to see that. But if we can think about, okay, I want my child to be an adult someday that knows how to be patient and self-controlled and all that, then it helps us to say, okay, we're not going to allow that type of behavior, and we're going to teach them to be different.
And so you're taking not just intentionally living, you're saying, I want to be intentionally parenting.
That's right.
And what kind of adult do I want here, mm-hmm. and how do I instill that?
That's right.
Why did you pick Strong and Kind? That's the title of the book, and those are the two character traits that you want to instill. Why those two?
Yeah, well, I chose those traits actually when John Luke and Sadie were young kids, and Willie and I talked about it, and you know, we wanted them to be strong because not just in who they are, but whose they are. We wanted their strength mm-hmm. to come from their faith, to know that God is with them, He is for them, and that, you know, whatever comes their way, they can withstand. And I know life is tough. You know, we're all going to go through difficult times. Nobody's immune to tough times on this world. And so I wanted them to be strong, to know that even though they might bend, they will not break because God is with them and He's holding them up. And then kindness, and that's for others. That's because, you know, if we're kinder, I think our world will be a much better place. You know, kindness, all the things that come along with kindness are compassion and generosity and all those things that caring about someone else. And I wanted them to be kind in the way they live their lives and the way they interact with others.
You're unusual, and I think it's an act of kindness for what you did, in that you not only had natural children, you went out and adopted. Why were you impelled to do that?
We did, and that was a really, well, growing up, our family was very hospitable. We always had someone living with us. We had a guest room that was never empty. We had mothers with children who needed a place. Maybe they came from abusive situations. We had several different families live with us, and I think my parents added it up. My parents added it up, and they said it was like over 80 people lived with us as we were growing up. And so, you know, our home, they practice hospitality, and so I understood that. And while they didn't adopt a child, we took in a lot of children at different times throughout their lives. And so my senior year in high school, my Bible teacher adopted. Mm. And, you know, he just really talked about the verse where God said, religion that is pure and faultless is taking care of widows and orphans. And I just resolved then that I wanted to adopt. And when Willie and I started dating, which we got married at 18, 19, so it wasn't much later than that. But we started dating, I told Willie, and he was like, absolutely. He was 100% on board from the very beginning. And you know, it was a decision that we knew we always wanted to do.
Wow. Was there a difference in parenting your natural children and your adopted children?
I think every child is different. That's yeah. God's great little joke on us, maybe. They're all a surprise. So, you know, in the way that, absolutely not, in that the way you love them and the way that they are yours 100%, just like we're God's adopted children, we are His and our children are ours, no matter how they came to us. But each child is absolutely different in their personalities and their talents and their strengths and their weaknesses. And so you have to parent each one differently.
Any challenges right now? I mean, you are, I would say, mega famous, not just famous, but you've hit a, you know, can you walk through airports anymore? Can you go to the mall? Can you go into the grocery store? People looking at you. Does that change how you parent?
I think it means that you have to talk to your kids even more. You know, I think that actually in every part of life, you know, people, whenever we decided to do this show, we heard a lot of fear from people. Are you sure you want to do this? Like, you know what happens to reality show kids or whatever. And I thought, you know, this is every family. You know, there's unique challenges to being a school teacher or being a pastor or being a, you know, whatever you are in life. You've got to focus on God and ask Him to, you know, to bless you and to care for you and to watch over you. And you got to, you know, stay within His path. So I don't think that it's necessarily unique, except for the fact that it has, you know, caused us to really make sure we prepare them for the road. We prepare them from each step, from the difficulties that might come with, you know, social media or other people, what other people might say or other people's thoughts or, you know, or even just people taking a picture of you when you walk down the airport, you know. We talk about being kind to everybody, those type of things.
Yeah, take the moment. Stay in the moment.
That's right.
Looking back, you've had a few years now of being strong and kind. You've had a few years of living intentionally and being an intentional parent. What are you most proud of?
Well, I'm proud of Willie and I, our 24 years of marriage. I think that's so important to your children, to teach your children. Every single thing, every single value can be summed up and shown in a good marriage and a healthy marriage, you know, because we've had difficult years like everybody else. You know, 24 years of marriage, it's not all easy, but
marriage is work.
Showing your kids that loyalty, that humility when it's tough, that saying you're sorry when you don't necessarily want to, you know, that showing love and compassion to your spouse. And so I think that the most important thing you can do for your kids is to love your spouse and to respect them and treat them well. And so I guess I'm most proud of that. And then my kids, of course, you know.
Yeah.
Couldn't be more proud of each of our kids. I was proud of them, you know, when they came out of the womb and when we got them, but I'm proud of them every day.
You ready to be a grandmother?
Yes, I am. I'm not sure what they're going to call me, but I am. I mean, of course, they still have college and all that to go, but when they're ready, absolutely be ready. Yes, I am.
I
love me some babies.
Okay. Well, the book from Korie Robertson, Strong and Kind, and Other Important Character Traits Your Child Needs to Succeed. I encourage you to get it. It's available wherever books are sold. And Korie, thanks so much for being with
us. Thank you.
God bless you. Thanks for having me. We'll be right back with more of 700 Club Interactive right after this. Imagine living where most children don't get enough to eat. Well, that's the reality in Haiti, where 1 in 5 children are underweight and 1 in 14 will die before reaching the age of 5. The hunger crisis there affects all aspects of life, especially education. CBN News reporter Caitlin Burke traveled to Haiti for a look at the solutions.
What if you had to go to school in stifling heat, do homework with little to no light, try and focus when you're also starving?
If kids are hungry, they can't learn. If they can't learn, they can never grow up and become the change that their country so desperately needs.
In Haiti, Pritchard and Dana Adams have seen this firsthand for more than 30 years. As a part of Rehoboth Ministries, they oversee 3 Christian schools.
We had children that were fainting in school, because of the heat and coming with an empty stomach. And we had a burden for years to be able to feed them. And we had a feeding program when we had 400 students at the main compound. But then the school began to grow and we just could not keep going. And we just prayed and prayed for the Lord to give a deliverance.
God answered their prayer in the form of CBN's Orphans Promise, which provided funds to start a feeding program in two of their schools.
Capacity we're geared for this year is 1,200 students a day. We have about 900 that we're feeding right now, so we still have 300 to go.
5 days a week, students eat a nutritious meal prepared by Haitian cooks here at the schools.
They're more alert. They're able to pay attention more. Makes all the difference. There's a Haitian proverb that says, sac vide pas campe, an empty sack cannot stand.
Dr. Patricia Wolf, founder of Meds and Food for Kids, or MFK, also saw a need when she started coming to Haiti in 1988.
I would come back the next time and the kids that you saw who were malnourished were sick again, and or sometimes they had died in the meantime.
After 15 years of medical mission volunteer work, Wolf decided to do something on a bigger scale.
So in 2003, we started with a little hand grinder and we mixed together peanuts, powdered milk, sugar, oil, and we gave the kids extra vitamins and minerals because in their mouth is a vitamin, rather because we didn't have the vitamins as powder. And we started that in a Methodist church schoolroom. And we made, that year, in 2003, we made 100 kilograms a month, and we treated 10 kids a month. And it was like a miracle. I mean, all the kids who looked half dead just popped up within a week or two and were cured in 6 to 8 weeks.
In 2012, MFK built this new state-of-the-art facility with the capacity to feed 80,000 children, turning raw peanuts like these into life-saving products.
Those products include Medicamamba for the severely malnourished, Plumpy Sup for moderate malnutrition and as a prenatal supplement, and Vitamamba, a school snack. All of the MFK products are made here, using local workers and, whenever possible, Haitian raw materials.
What we need to do in Haiti is go beyond rescue. We need to rescue people who are likely to die and don't have enough nutritious food to eat, but that doesn't go anywhere unless you actually develop the country, ignite economic development, and employ their parents so that the next child and the next child in that family are not also malnourished.
These products give desperate parents a way to fight their children's malnutrition and keep their families together.
A really common reason why a child would be in orphanage is because the parents can't feed them, not because there are no parents.
Haitian children from 6 months to 3 or 4 years old are the core group facing malnutrition. That's the age when their brains are developing. Without proper nutrition, they'll never be as smart or healthy as they could be.
We have to go with the kids because the kids are the future and they are the most likely to be damaged, and we know how to fix it. We just have to put resources into it. We have to be determined to put resources into it.
MFK now exports products to other developing countries, with both UNICEF and the World Food Program as major customers. But even with the organization's growth, Dr. Wolf says her work is far from over.
The world really shouldn't be this way. So, you know, the way I feel about it is that there's some people in the world, like the people who are born in North America or Europe, who kind of won the lottery. It isn't happening here. If you saw a stranger drowning, you would jump in and try to save them, and that's pretty much my motivation.
Caitlin Burke, CBN News, Cap Haitien, Haiti.
Nutrition is absolutely key to education. Without it, children don't learn, their brains don't develop, they don't have the neural connections. So doing that, taking a holistic approach where you're not just saying we're going to give a handout, we're going to give a hand up, is the absolute solution. How do you change a country? Well, you need to take an entire generation to say we're going to walk you through, we're going to fill that sack so you can stand up. Well, Haiti is not the only country where children are hungry. In eastern India, one little boy spent his days on the streets begging for food.
Every day, from dawn until dusk, Sidhu sings throughout his small village in India. It's the only way the five-year-old can make enough money to buy food.
My father died before I was born, and my mother died the day she gave birth to me.
His grandmother sells firewood she collects from the jungle, while Sidhu begs at the shops. She makes enough to live on her own, but sometimes their combined income isn't enough to buy food for them both. So she decided to take him to a children's home supported by Orphans Promise. Here he has food every day, and he's enrolled in a Christian school.
Before coming here, I had to work all the time, but now I can go to school and learn many things.
It didn't take long before Sidhu asked Jesus to be his Lord and Savior. Now, instead of singing for food, he sings about God's love.
My new parents and friends love me so much. I really like it here.
You can be a part of it. You can be a part of everything we do around the world. How do you do that? You just join the 700 Club. How much is it? $20 a month, 65 cents a day, and you join with tens of thousands of people that say, yes, I want to make a difference in the world today. If you want to be a part of helping people, if you want to be a part of feeding children, if you want to be a part of preaching the gospel, join the 700 Club. A portion of every gift goes into the work of Operation Blessing to help people around the world. Another portion goes into the work of CBN International to preach the gospel around the world. And you're a part of all of it when you join the 700 Club. So do it now. Call us, 888-777-1999. Or you can log on to 700clubinteractive.com. And there's a place on the homepage where you can click to give. And when you give, ask for Pledge Express. That's electronic monthly giving where the bank does all the work. There are no checks to write, nothing to mail in. We save so much on the processing we can send as our gift to you. Power for Life, monthly teaching CDs. So if you like those, ask for Pledge Express when you call or just give monthly on the website. Well, still ahead, a mother who realized her 14-year-old had a dark secret on the day her daughter killed herself.
There was a conversation at the moment she died. I mean, I've been married 17 years and I haven't had conversations like that with my husband.
Find out what was so shocking about this conversation and learn how to tell if your child is having one like it. Up next. For one Alabama mother, the pain of suicide became a reality after her 14-year-old daughter took her own life. Well, now she's on a mission to warn parents about how strangers can influence the lives of their children, especially on the internet or even on their smartphones. Charlene Aaron brings us that story from Pell City, Alabama.
Jennifer Sellers surrounds herself with memories and pictures of her daughter, Sydney.
She was beautiful, took after her dad.
Their relationship appeared as close as any mother and daughter could be.
We went and got hair together. We did nails together. We did Walmart together.
Yet Sydney kept secrets. Those secrets would lead to tragedy on December 7th, 2014, when Sellers found her teenage daughter hanging from a belt in her bedroom.
It was such a shock that I opened the door and I said, Sydney, that is not a funny practical joke.
Only it was real.
I immediately ran into the room, and so I didn't have the strength to pick her up. That's when I started screaming for my husband. He picked her up. I cut her down. We laid her down on the ground, and he immediately started CPR, and I called 911.
Sellers, a child advocacy attorney, still struggles to understand why her daughter would commit such a drastic act, especially since she had shown no signs of depression or trouble. Even the morning of her death, Sydney gladly attended church with her family.
Went to Mass. Really proud that day. That was her first day as an altar server. So we were just excited, you know. She's in the robes and she's going to be up on the altar, and she did a great job.
As word spread of Sydney's death, her family learned from friends that she had been bullied at school and had also been cutting herself. Yet nothing prepared them for an online conversation they discovered on Sydney's smartphone. At the time of her death, Sydney and a stranger had been messaging one another on an app called Kick. The subject, erotic asphyxiation, or breath control play, which is the intentional restriction of oxygen to the brain for the purposes of sexual arousal.
I mean, I've been married 17 years and I haven't had conversations like that with my husband. There was a conversation happening at the moment she died between her and a person who purported himself to be a teenage boy. And it was disgusting. And he was giving her instructions on things to do.
Sexually?
Yes. Very sexually.
Many teens log on to the internet from the privacy of their own bedrooms, not from a PC, but from a mobile device, like a smartphone or a tablet. And they're often connecting with people they don't really know. And their parents are completely unaware.
Predators are everywhere on the internet. They know which sites kids tend to populate and go to. They pose as someone that a child might easily talk to.
Smartphone apps are often the weapons used to target kids.
They know how to lure these kids into what looks like harmless things and get them talking.
What parents need to realize is that your teens are living in an entirely different world on social media.
CBN producer Caleb Kinchlow showed us some of the popular apps used by teens to connect on the internet, often with strangers.
You know, Facebook is not the most popular app like it used to be. You know, now it's Instagram, Snapchat, Uvu, Kick, Vine. Teens are more willing to share information that they normally wouldn't be comfortable sharing, including nude pictures, mature content, and things of that nature.
Seller says the man chatting with Sydney could not be traced because the Kick app allows users to connect anonymously. Today, this grieving mother spends time talking to troubled teenagers and encourages parents to keep up with their kids' lives, something she regrets not doing with her own child.
I had gotten complacent. My husband had gotten complacent. She went to school, she came back, she did her work, she made great grades, you know. We figured we were good there.
Mental says parents need to monitor their kids' internet activity as much as possible.
They need to be able to look at every device and say, is there a way to access the internet from that device? Because a lot of people don't think about like an Xbox being able to get on the internet from there. So you need to think about what devices do we have in the house? How is the access set up? What are the settings?
Sellers agrees.
Most parents are fine if their kids run off on their tablets or their phones for an hour before they have to get in the shower and go to bed. They're not monitoring that. If you bought that phone, if you pay for that phone, I don't care what they say about their privacy. That is your property. You have a right to know what's on it. Search it out, and you need to know what's going on with your kids' electronics.
A move that, while unpopular, just might save a life. Charlene Aaron, CBN News, Pell City, Alabama.
Wise words from a parent who has a lot of regret that she didn't do that. Take advantage of that advice and find out what your children are doing, just for your own peace of mind. And maybe you'll see some early warning signs that you can interfere, you can be part of their life. And show them a better way to go. If you want more new information about this, we've got it for you on cbnnews.com, how you can be informed about what apps to watch out for, what kind of conversations to look for. It's all available for you. All you have to do is go to cbnnews.com. We leave you this word from Ephesians: be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. God bless you. We'll see you again.